Hello, everybody. Thanks for joining, and thanks for the opportunity to present some information on how several aspects of CrossFit or any multi-domain exercise program can improve both longevity and cognitive function. I do have some conflicts of interest to declare up front. The majority of my research and my day job is funded by the government, by the NIH. I also have some consulting relationships with professional companies. Hintsa, Thriver, and Sidekick are for-profit companies in the health arena. I have consulting agreements with them. I also have positions at a couple of institutes, the IHMC and Brainstorm at the University of South Carolina. I'm also a founding trustee of the British Society of Lifestyle Medicine, and I have an affiliation with Food for the Brain, which is a large charity, dementia charity in the UK. So just as a brief overview of what we're going to talk about today, as you know, there are several pillars to a CrossFit program, and many of those have a lot of evidence to support them in terms of how they might improve both how long we live, as well as how well we live, and how we might maintain cognitive function late into life. So the ones that I'm going to specifically focus on are aerobic fitness, muscle mass and strength, coordination and skill development, and community, which, as you all know, is a very important part of the CrossFit movement. So just as a general overview, we can say that both muscle and movement itself are geroprotective, which is a fancy word for anti-aging. And if you look at the things that happen when we age, there's lots of evidence to support the fact that each individual aspect of aging can be directly either countered or prevented by exercise. It's interesting that both exercise itself is beneficial for health through multiple mechanisms, as well as being the opposite of being sedentary, which is actively negative for our health. So we know that if we're sedentary, if we don't move very much, that increases inflammation, increases insulin resistance. And at the same time, we can actively reverse those things or do the exact opposite with multiple kinds of exercise. And you can see that here there's some references at the bottom, but multiple lines of research suggest that. So starting with aerobic fitness, we know that aerobic exercise can actively grow our brains. In the first study where we saw that you could do an intervention in older adults and see some of the brain grow in size or grow back, was using a brisk walking intervention, just brisk walking for 40 minutes, three times a week for a year. And what they saw was that the size of the hippocampus, which is a part of the brain that's particularly important in memory and we lose as we start to go into cognitive decline, that the size of that area of the brain increased with this walking intervention. And the increase was directly correlated to how much aerobic fitness improved, particularly related to the improvement in VO2 max, the amount of maximum oxygen the body can use. And this, again, was correlated with production in something called BDNF, or brain-derived neurotrophic factor. So the more aerobic exercise we do, the fitter we become, and the more BDNF we produce, which directly supports growth of the brain. If we then think about longevity overall, like how long we might live, there are two different graphs you'll see here. So on the left-hand side, this is data from over 100,000 people where they did exercise testing and they looked at their VO2 max, and then they classified them into five different groups. So low was people in the bottom 25%, below average, below 50%, above average, above 50%, high around 75%, and elite like the top 2 or 3% of VO2 max. And what you see then in terms of risk of death is that as your fitness improves, or your risk of death decreases linearly. And in the same kind of way, on the right-hand side, you'll see graphs looking at how both walking and running reduce the risk of all-cause mortality. So your overall risk of death based on the amount of exercise that you do each day, either walking or running. One of the main reasons why I want to show these graphs is to show you that regardless of where you start, any additional increase in running, walking, or improvement in aerobic fitness is linearly related to the amount of benefit you get in terms of reducing your mortality risk. So no matter where you start, any amount that you add is beneficial. It's not necessarily me telling you that you need to try and hit the top of this graph, which is a challenge that I think a lot of people might take. However, it is worth bearing in mind that you can have too much of a good thing. And you'll see for the running graph particularly, on the right-hand side, as you start to get to like more than an hour of intense running every day, you might start to see a drop off in terms of benefits. So you can't have too much of a good thing, but literally anything you can do, regardless of where you start, is beneficial in terms of your risk of death. So if you then do start to do some kind of program, or you have your patient start to try do some kind of program, how do you know if their VO2 max or their aerobic fitness is improving? And sort of most simply, it has improved if they have an improved work capacity in the sort of 5 to 15 minute max effort range. So this is hopefully some kind of activity that's not skill or strength limited. Might be something like a 10 minute max distance on the assault bike. If your distance improves in that 10 minute time, then we know that your aerobic fitness, your VO2 max is improving. There are more formal ways to do this if you want. So obviously a lab-based VO2 max test on a treadmill or something like that is the gold standard. However, we can also calculate it from some other tests. So there's something called the Cooper run test, where you run as far as you can in 12 minutes, and then there are equations to calculate your VO2 max based on that. Similarly, there's a 2K row test on the Concept 2 rower. If you do that, then your time and your weight can be used to convert that into a VO2 max. More simply, depending on the scenario that you work in, there are 3 minute step tests where you have a fixed height of a step, and then you step a fixed number of times a minute for 3 minutes, usually somewhere between 20 and 25 steps per minute. And then your heart rate at the end of the 3 minutes is directly correlated to your VO2 max. And there are equations that you can find and calculators that you can find for all those things online. So what about lean mass and strength? This graph you see here, this is nice data from the NHANES cohort. That's the National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey in the US. It's meant to sort of represent an average population in the US. And these are mortality curves based on the amount of lean mass that somebody has. And what you can see is the top two lines have the shallowest decrease. And this is basically the top two quartiles of lean mass. So basically, if you're in the top 50% of lean mass in the population, you have a significantly reduced chance of death compared to those who have less lean mass than that, less muscle mass than that. Similarly, if you look at how strong people are, the stronger you are in general, the longer you live. So this graph here is from the Honolulu Heart Program study. And what you see at the bottom there is a grip strength from the participants. And these are generally ranged from their 50s to 60s and were followed for 20 years or more. And those who are in the top third of grip strength have almost the same benefit in terms of longevity compared to the lowest third of grip strength as people who have mothers aged more than 80 years versus more than 60 years before they die. So we know that how old your mother lives is a big predictor of how long you will live. And your grip strength is just as good as a predictor as that. Similarly, when we go back to cognitive function, we know that the amount of muscle mass that you have is directly correlated with how much brain you have inside your skull, adjusting for the size of your skull and things like that. So this is a study where they looked at this. And on the left-hand side, you'll see all the different metrics of body composition and other things related to that, and how they correlate with brain volume, you know, how much brain you have to fill your skull. And you'll see things like body mass index, BMI, doesn't correlate. The p-value is above 0.05. Body fat doesn't correlate either, but lean mass, which is right at the bottom, is significantly correlated with the amount of brain that you have. And that's what you see in the graph on the right. Similarly, lean mass or muscle mass is positively correlated. So the more muscle mass you have, the higher your score on a cognitive function test. This is data from the UK Biobank, which shows that basically the more muscle you have, on average, the higher your fluid intelligence score. So again, similarly, as well as just the volume of brain that you have, its function as well seems to be correlated with how much muscle mass you have. So then you might ask, well, how do I know if I have enough muscle? And so on the left and right here, you have graphs that I have done. These are analyses that I have done from, again, the NHANES data set. And on the x-axis at the bottom, you'll see FFMI, which is the fat-free mass index, which is essentially the same as BMI after you have taken away body fat. So it's your amount of muscle divided by your height in meters squared. And the y-axis is your risk of death. And so in women, you'll see that the risk of death becomes non-significantly different. It crosses that line at zero, at an FFMI of 14, and is probably lowest around an FFMI of 16 or 17. And in males, it crosses at around 17 and is its lowest between 20 and 21. And so using these kinds of ranges, you can calculate this online yourself. So all you need to know is your height, your weight, and some estimate of your body fat percentage. You could do that with calipers. You can do that with different measurements around the body. There are ways that you can do it just by looking at photos. There are some things for that online. If you want to, you do sort of more like the gold standard, you can get a DEXA scan. They're pretty inexpensive and used in a number of places currently. So any of that, you can calculate FMI, and then you know what you need to kind of achieve to have enough muscle. And importantly, you know, no real heroics required here. As long as you're in the top 50% of the population, you seem to be protected in terms of a mortality standpoint. So the next thing that I wanted to briefly cover on was community and cognitive decline. So we know that if you have poor social engagement, you don't have a community around you, you don't have very many friends, you have an increased risk of dementia or Alzheimer's disease. You see that on the right there. And similarly, if you have good social engagement, you have a good community, people who can help you, people who you help, you have a reduced risk of cognitive decline or dementia. That's what you see on the left. And we also see exactly the same thing for overall mortality. You know, the better your social support, the better your social connection, the longer you live. And part of this is connected to the fact that we as human beings need to have some kind of connection to the outside world, and some kind of we need some kind of use, or else we will slowly decline as our bodies realize that, you know, for whatever reason, we're not telling it that it's that useful. The data that I'm showing you now kind of makes that point, where in multiple studies, after adjusting for things like medical reasons why people might retire early, the earlier you retire, it seems like the earlier you die. And it really is a case of, like, for both your brain and your body, you have to use it or you will lose it. And when in my day job, I study the developing brain. And if we think about the things that you ask your brain to do early on, you ask a lot of your brain, and that's part of you developing, you know, a strong, healthy, well-connected brain. So you ask your brain to learn how to walk, learn how to talk, to learn social interactions. These are very complex tasks that require, that provide a lot of stimulus for the developing brain. Then over our lifetime, we might learn to drive, and that's, you know, it's difficult, but it's much less difficult than learning how to walk in the first place. You know, you might go to medical school, you could learn biochemistry, and though the Krebs cycle is also difficult to learn, it is much less difficult to learn than talking in the first place. And then we go to work, we ask even less of our brains because we do the same thing again and again and again. We have protocols for treating everything that we do. And then we retire, we ask even less of our brain. And maybe we can sort of reverse a little bit of that by, you know, doing some Sudoku like you see at the end there, but still we're not really asking very much right at the end. And so there's a huge discrepancy in the demands we place on our brains in late life compared to early in life. And this process is associated with a decline in the function of the brain because we're just asking it to do less. So this is where I think some of the benefits of other aspects of a CrossFit type training strategy can be beneficial. And that is because the brain benefits from doing things that you suck at. And here is some data in the middle. And it's a complex graph, but you'll see sort of bottom left, you'll see professional musicians and amateur musicians. And what this graph shows you is a score called the brain age score. So you put your person in an MRI scanner, and then a machine learning algorithm predicts how old that brain looks relative to their actual real age or chronological age. And what you'll see is that compared to non-musicians, which are just above the middle of the x-axis, professional musicians have a younger brain. So the act of playing and learning music, it seems to be beneficial in terms of how old your brain looks. But amateur musicians have an even bigger effect. And that is because they are not very good at it. So the process of doing something difficult, like learning a musical instrument, and not being good at it is a significant stimulus for our brains. And this is something that we need to continue doing late into life. And one of the best ways to do this, actually, is to challenge our coordination and balance. And this is because it seems that mismatches in the vestibular or balance system, so challenging your balance, is a great stimulus for plasticity. And that's probably because it's more of a threat. You know, if you are constantly challenged in sort of your physical space, that is a stimulus for change, because obviously something, there's a mismatch there and you need to fix that. So you'll see the graph in the middle here. This is from a randomized clinical trial where they randomized older adults either to dancing or to, here they had sport, which is kind of, it was kind of like a sort of a cross training type workout. And you'll see that those in the dance group actually often had bigger improvements or bigger increases in certain volumes in the brain. And when you then look at the literature as a whole, if you look at how different types of exercise improve cognitive function or prevent cognitive decline, coordinative exercise, so exercise that includes challenging your balance, has the biggest effect on long-term cognitive function. So you might think of things like yoga, slacklining, surfing, gymnastics, certainly in the box. All of these things are going to be challenging your coordination, and that may have an even bigger effect in terms of protecting your long-term cognitive function. And this kind of brings me to sort of like an overriding theory that underpins a lot of what we're talking about today, which is that over time, you know, both in the population at large and as we get older, we really ask less of our bodies and our brains. And this results in less repair, more degradation, and reduced capacity. So the less we ask of our brains and our bodies, the less we're able to do. However, if we can challenge it with these processes of failing, that's what we really see when we see the benefits in amateur musicians, then we could do the opposite. We're asking a lot of our brains. These are difficult tasks, similar with challenging our bodies on our, you know, muscles, both aerobically and from a strength and power standpoint. And then so more demands, more repair, more capacity, and this then will maintain function later into life. So how do you know if you have enough skills, having done all this and challenged it? And the answer is that you probably never will. And it's really important to embrace things that you're difficult at. And then once you're good at something, you need to do something else to continue to get a new stimulus. So we might think of things like movement with a balance component, like I said. There are other skills, certainly. So we already mentioned music, but languages, including computer languages, coding, teaching, these things in the literature have been shown to provide a kind of stimulus that's associated with much longer term cognitive function. Now, I know that everybody here is probably in some way connected to the CrossFit community, but it's important from, you know, a general health and public health standpoint that, you know, not everybody necessarily has the time or the opportunity to do a CrossFit style program. And so I really want to now mention that it's really easy to get a lot of these benefits with very minimal investment of time or resources. So the graph that you're seeing here, this is mortality rate based on steps per day. And again, you'll see that no matter how many more steps you do each day from 2000 down to 10,000, you're going to see a reduction in your mortality risk. So if you only do 2000 steps, or your mother, your friend only does 2000 steps, and you can get them to 4000 steps, it's a huge improvement in their mortality risk. And the older they are, the greater that benefit. So you can see huge amounts of benefit here just by adding some brisk walking. As kind of a technical definition, brisk walking is officially defined as 100 steps per minute. So you can time that if you really want to know how brisk brisk walking is. Similarly, this is a graphical abstract from a nice paper that just came out called No Time to Lift. So if you don't have time to get down to the box several times a week, how can you still get muscle and strength benefits? And what they really show from their analysis of the literature is that 4 sets per week, 6 to 15 reps per set, you know, maybe just 3 compound movements like a squat, a pull-up, and some kind of press, that's probably going to be enough to see significant benefit. So you could do this with body weight and maybe some kind of band setup at home, so you could do some rows or pulls, less than an hour a week to see significant benefits in terms of strength and muscle mass. And so to kind of summarize that, this what you see now is my great upside down movement pyramid, which I came up with a few years ago, that kind of sort of prioritizes all the different aspects of fitness that we could incorporate into our lives in order to see improved health and longevity. And the more that you do, the more unstable the pyramid becomes. That's the idea. And then you need to, you know, focus more on rest and recovery and sleep and all those other kind of things. So things that anybody can do. They can sit less, they can walk more, they can move stuff. You know, it could be a $3 sandbag. It doesn't need to be expensive dumbbells. And then as you've done those things, you can add sprints and longer distance cardio if you want. And again, none of this requires a huge amount of monetary investment if that's not something that's available to people. So in summary, I think we can say that several aspects of CrossFit drive longevity through aerobic fitness, muscle and strength, community, as well as coordination and skills. The same benefit can be available to anybody, you know, both inside and outside a formal CrossFit environment. And it's very important to fail frequently. That's what drives change. And the majority of our health and fitness benefits late into life. So thank you very much.